All right, camera's on. All right, let's turn on the light. Ah, Jesus. Oh my God, it's been so long. Hey, what's going on? My name is Payne. Welcome back to another video. I know I've been gone for almost a month. It's been a while since I made a video, but I've been taking this time not only to pay attention to what I've been doing during school and really just get some of the important stuff out of the way, but also to look back at what the hell I've been doing since I started making this. So I decided to dial down a little bit on the, definitely on the enthusiasm. I felt like I went like a little like too far on the enthusiasm. You're probably gonna hear in this video that there's no music, and I am gonna be trying to slowly crawl back into making more videos, not just making the same content, but just making videos in general, because the next few months are just going to be straight up hell, considering I'm going to be graduating. So I'm going to try and make some videos when I can. This is one example of it. This is a video that I wanted to make after I saw a post on r/anime on Reddit about a month ago, but I never really looked at it until just recently. And shortly after that is when I started watching the stuff that were suggested on there. It was a Reddit post known as the 5 Horrifying Art House Anime. The guy wasn't ranking it or anything. He was just listing it out on there, just suggesting it for people. And I decided that because of how short the OVAs were, and because that I'm pretty sure when I got into this, nobody I knew what these were. And then I told a couple of people what they were for a couple of these shows. I thought it was a pretty good video topic. So here are my opinions on the 5 horrifying art house anime. A couple of things. First off, for anyone who wanted to see the Reddit post, that is down in the description down below. I also found out while making the script for this video that some of the videos are actually on YouTube. So I'm gonna find as much as I can of these 5 in the description, and so you can get and you can watch them. I'm sorry if I stutter a little bit. I'm trying to get used to. I edited the script. It's not word for word. It's just bullet points. I gotta get used to that. Oh, right, I forgot. And spoilers. If there's any, I'm gonna be talking about spoilers of all of them except for, I think, one. Because I wrote down in the bullet point, like, yeah, there's gonna be no spoilers for this. I suggest you watch the 5 down in the description before you come back up and hear me talk about it. So, those are just a couple of warnings right there. Now I'm gonna get this out of the way. These are the 5 horrifying art house anime. At number 5 is an OVA that was made back in 1997 known as The Eternal Family. It was directed by a guy named Koji Morimoto, who has worked on a bunch of other movies, especially such as Akira, Mind's Game, Kiki's Delivery Service, callback to my last review on that, and Fist of the North Star. He also co-wrote this, and he also co-founded the studio that made it, Studio 4 Degrees Celsius. It came out on April 1st, 1997, as a 28-minute OVA, that's what it was according to my anime list, because if you look at Wikipedia, this is the weird part. If you look at Wikipedia, it says that from April of 1997 to March of 1998, there were 53 30-second episodes that were released weekly, which makes no sense. I think someone was just fucking around with the Wikipedia, and even if it was serious, why would you do that? That makes no sense. It's on the same level as trying to watch Boogie Pop or Bakano weekly, where you're trying to pay attention to what's going on. I guess it's one of those things where it's best if you binge watch it. I don't know what the hell anybody was thinking when they made this. Or even if that was the case. Where's that guy? Where's that guy about like a month ago that was said to have edited the most Wikipedia posts? Where is he? We need him for this. But no, really, this is a very interesting show for a number of reasons. The first one is that, again, this was made back in 1997. When you watch this, it has aspects of a couple of shows, a couple of movies, primarily The Matrix and The Truman Show, for anyone who's watched that. And they predate both of them. So I thought that was interesting. One assumption that I got from watching this, and I think I should say what the synopsis of the show is first, it follows a group of people who are forced by an organization, who are brainwashed, to live together in a capsule of some sort while they're being surveillance, and it's supposed to be like this social experiment. But after a while, the organization was starting to lose money. And one of the guys was like, screw it, and decided to sell one of the tapes they had of the family. And overnight, like literally overnight, they became a national sensation. almost in the form of a reality TV show. Then, after a while, the family escapes from the capsule, they find out how popular they were, and the OVA ends with them being recaptured and brainwashed again into being a family. The only person who knows what's going on is the main guy. His name is Ben, I think. And he's the only one that really knows about this whole thing that's inside the capsule and is all for it. He doesn't say anything to the rest of the family members. And it was from finding out what the synopsis was that got me an pretty solid assumption, which was that Koji Morimoto or the studio or, yeah, the people who made this were inspired by reality shows. I think I talked about reality shows at some point in the past. I think it was the, I think it was the High School of the Dead review where I compared how the characters were acting to each other to that of a reality show. In this case, I have no idea what reality shows were going on in the late 90s in Japan, but I do know that there was one significant reality show that this reminds me of that has the same concept, and that was Real World. I know that because there was a couple of seasons that were here in Seattle, and it's basically the same thing. There's groups of people from different backgrounds. They're forced to be together and live together, and that's seen as a form of entertainment, and I think that's what Eternal Family is trying to, that's their message as well. And it's because of that that I see Eternal Family. It's on the same level as Perfect Blue with Satoshi Kon. On the same level as that, as one of the greatest movies I ever saw because of how relevant it is in the near future. Because Perfect Blue, for people who don't know, talked about the dangers of cyberbullying, cyber stalking. Even though it was a big deal in the late 90s, it has gotten bigger and it's now easier to understand if you watch it now, 21 years later. But if you watch Eternal Family, it's kind of the same thing. It kind of predicted this rise of reality shows. There wasn't that many, but it's on the same area as Perfect Blue, whereas that they knew that there was this thing going on, they made a story about it, and it ended up growing and turning into this big thing, just like what Perfect Blue predicted. Now, onto Eternal Family itself. The animation really stood out because, really, of how surreal it was. The backdrops and the setting really helped. The backdrops of the setting of the capsule or inside it or the city when they're out there, that was very exciting. The characters, to me, were more like more hit or miss. I really like the main guy because, really, he's the only sane character. I mean, sure, I like the other characters, but I think it's just because he's the only one I can relate to. I mean, that's kind of a lie, but I'm just saying that in this case. And I'm not joking when I say that he's the only sane person. The wife, the quote-unquote wife in this, is apparently very constipated. There are two daughters. There's one who's obsessed with her ex-husband, even though because it's not real. And there's another daughter who's apparently is so schizophrenic that she argues with a hand puppet a lot. Like, apparently that's how bad it is. There's a son who, for some reason, I think it's because of ratings, to be honest. I think the organization just straight up gave it to him. He has a fucking machine gun. I don't know why. He uses it to, like, wreak havoc all over the capsule, but shit! Like, I assume it's because of ratings, but at the same time, this was before, like, the entire world started freaking out about kids with guns, so I assume it was okay at the time. And then there's a few comic relief characters. There is a baby that just, fucks around with a couple of pets. Not like that, you pervs. There is a dog that the organization put in, and then there was a pet chicken that the organization gave to the family for them to kill and eat, but they just took it as a pet anyway, and they just start messing around with the baby, and that's just really, it's obnoxious. It reminds me of 2000s Cartoon Network shows, and I love it. I don't know if there's anything else to say. If you like watching dystopian stuff, then I suggest you watch this. I'm gonna give Eternal Family a 7 out of 10. Alright, at number 4 is an OVA that lasted 4 episodes. It's the only OVA that lasted more than one episode. And it is a OVA that was made by JC Staff. It was directed by Jiro Fujimoto, who only directed episode 1, and Yasuhiro Idei, or I think I'm saying his name right, in his directorial debut, and he directed episodes 2, 3, and 4. He later directed Full Metal Alchemist Brotherhood, if that name sounds familiar to people. It came out in the summer of 2001. It is a show known as Alien 9. The main story of Alien 9 follows a fifth grade girl who has been voted by her class to be a part of this club with two other girls in a group where they have to kill aliens that have landed next to their elementary school. And it reminds me of a lot of shows. One of the shows that it reminds me of is Monica Magica. And the reason why I remember that very clearly is because the guy who made the Reddit post said that, you know, this show is basically Monica Magica 10 years before Monica Magica was made, because it involves Moe girls being forced to fight beings against their will. But in my opinion, this OVA and the manga that came before it, I'm pretty sure it's the only one that was an adaptation of a manga. I believe that it was inspired by a show that came before this one. And it all lies on the main character of Alien 9. Because if you see, when she says that she doesn't want to go and fight these aliens, she has constant nightmares and she cries a lot. You start to notice that she is basically the pristine female equivalent, the carbon copy of Shinji Ikari from Neon Genesis Evangelion. The only difference is that instead of the teacher, the advisor, telling her to, you know, get in the fucking robot, they're telling her to put a fucking live alien on your head and go shoot some intergalactic bastards. Also, fun fact, the advisor in the dub is voiced by Veronica Taylor, who is the OG Ash from Pokemon. I just wanted to say that because I think that's pretty cool. Another thing that this guy brings up in his explanation of Alien 9 is that the exact meaning for this show is very vague and blurry, but in my opinion, alongside the central feeling that you get from the show, which is similar to, if not the exact central feeling that you get from Evangelion, which is existential dread, Alien 9 is a very depressing coming-of-age OVA that highlights the struggles of growing up and being left behind, especially in the fourth and final episode of this OVA, which was the most experimental out of all four episodes. I thought that there were some scenes that were just, to be honest, I thought they crossed the line a little bit. And then I found out, according to the Reddit post, that the manga author was approached by fans with assumptions that some of the scenes were inspired by child abuse, to which the manga author had to deny that that was the case. But because that was brought up, it does make a lot of sense. But regardless, considering that the OVA only adapted half of the manga and that there has been numerous attempts, apparently, to revamp it, to bring it back up ever since, I still think that this was a very good OVA. It's one of the best unfinished OVA, or one of the best unfinished stories I've ever seen. The smart directing added to the surreal feel of the show, the offbeat soundtrack added to it, and it had something that, you know, you could say Monica Magica or its creator, Akiyuki Shimbo of Shaft, was inspired to get from the show, and that is to add to the horror by adding a Moe style to it. If you like this OVA, I highly suggest you read the manga. The OVA adapts, I think, only a volume and a half, and there's like three volumes total. I highly suggest you read the rest of the manga if you like this, if you are one of those people, but I'm going to give Alien 9 an 8 out of 10 because I am one of those people. Alright, our next one is a 28-minute OVA that came out in March of 2012, known as Wasuda Nagumo, also known as Little Spider Girl. And no, it is not going where you think it's going. It was directed by Toshiya Kaya and was made by Production IG for the Young Animator Training Project, and it was 28 minutes long. The story follows a shopkeeper named Suzuri, and the granddaughter of the landlord of the bookstore that Suzuri works in, named Miyuki, who opens up an old book and comes out this spider girl. Now, after a while, she lives in the bookstore that they both work at, mainly. I remember she was freaking Miyuki out. I thought that was pretty funny. But then she tells both of them that she wants to see her mom, which foreshadows back to the book that she came out from, because in that book, there is a story that tells of a giant spider monster that lives in a lake that's not too far from the bookstore. They go to the old lake house that borders the lake, and the short ends with a very, very shocking plot twist. And this is the one thing I'm not actually going to spoil. I'm going to find this on YouTube. I'm going to put it in the description, and I'm actually going to make you watch this, because I'm not going to say the ending. The ending was pretty freaky. But even though that the ending really got me, if we're looking at this experimental-wise, this was my least favorite out of the five. It was pretty underwhelming because, just like everything else, I approached this short thinking it was going to be like the other ones. That it was going to be, you know, pretty experimental. It was going to be something out there. I've heard people praise about it, and I really don't see it, apart from the ending. Yeah, I think that's all I can, all I'm going to say. The characters were pretty enjoyable. There were some slapstick scenes with the Spider-Girl in the bookstore. I think that was pretty entertaining, but it was the wrong emotion that I wanted, because when you find a post that says five horrifying art house anime, you expect all five of them to be horrifying. I mean, the ending was the closest thing to anything close to horrifying, and it didn't even scare me. But, you know, it may scare you, it may scare the person next to you, it may scare anybody, to be honest. I mean, I wasn't freaked out by it. If anything, I said it was underwhelming, but it was still pretty good nonetheless. I'm gonna give Little Spider Girl a 6 out of 10. All right, our next one at number 2, or at least that's how the guy listed it on the Reddit post, is not an OVA, but is a music video. I think I said at the beginning of the video that there was a music video in this. Now we're at the music video, made by Yoko Kuno back in July of 2013, known as Airy Me. Now this is, I know for a fact, because the person who made the post linked the YouTube video as well. Currently, oh god, I forgot how many views it has, but it's like too low. It should have 1 million views. I know it's under 1 million. I don't want to look it up now because I'm already right in the middle of this. But apart from that, it's still like really good, and it's really surprising how much effort Yoko Kuno put into this music video. It was made for a song of the same name that was made in 2009. It was again made in 2013, and the woman made it, couldn't get the words out, using 3,000 still images that she made that were hand-drawn over a span of 2 years. She finalized it then with Adobe Photoshop and After Effects, but 2 years? I'm sorry. I couldn't believe it when I heard that it was 2 years long. Now, after this, she would get into a few animation roles as well. Most notably, she did the ending, and she was an episode director for Hosuke no Kuni, also known as Land of the Lustrous. It came out back in 2017, I think? I think so? Something like that. Yeah, I think it was 2017. It's been a while since I've watched it. And the story in the music video follows a mental patient as he turns into a hybrid creature known as a chimera. For anyone who doesn't know what that is a combination of, I think it was like a lion, a dragon, and I forgot what the third one was. It is a, like, mythical hybrid of some sort. And as he turns into a non-human, it is revealed that he still has human emotions, especially love and affection towards the nurse. And it's because of that, the music video shows something that it's really hard to describe. Like, the only thing that I can really say about the ending was that it's beautiful and it's disturbing at the very same time. The story is very, very, very captivating. As well as the song. I mean, the song fits extremely well with the video, which you gotta admit, it defeats the purpose of a music video if the video doesn't fit with the song. But you know, I'm just gonna say it right here, the song fits really well. And you gotta be the biggest idiot in the world to not say that a lot of heart and a lot of effort and a lot of emotion was put into this. Because I don't know if I gotta say this again. She put 2 years of effort in this. And it's really good. The constant change of pace and the fantastical elements blend together to make the video an emotional roller coaster that you don't want to get off of. And with that, I'm going to give it a 9 out of 10. And now we are on to the final show. This one is my personal favorite. It is a short known as Cat Soup, also known as Nekajiro, that came out in February 21st, 2001. It was also made by JC Staff before Alien 9, and it was a 34-minute long short. It was directed by Tatsuo Sato, and it was co-written by Sato and, get this, Masaaki Yuasa. Yeah, he also was a part of this as well. But even though that, you know, if Yuasa's in it, if Yuasa's working on it, then the short is immediately good, the backstory behind it is something that I don't think I'll ever forget for the rest of my life. So to give you guys some context, I'm going to start off with the backstory first before I mention the actual Sure. So the story begins in 1990 when a woman by the name of Chiyomi Hashiguchi created a comic under the name Nekojiro, or Cat Soup, where her works revolved around two cat siblings, an older sister named Nyako and a younger brother named Niyata, as they go around causing mayhem everywhere with a fair share of macabre violence, because that was the norm. If you watch Cat Soup, there is a fair number of macabre violence. That is because it was in the shorts. After a couple of years, her works became ridiculously popular in Japan, but as her works got very popular, as it went up, her sanity went down, and eventually she was diagnosed with manic depression. She drank a lot. She isolated herself in her room. According to one article, apparently she was playing like a lot of Kingdom Hearts, and that was her daily life. She would still make stuff. It was just the fame got to her. And unfortunately, on May 10th, 1998, she committed suicide at the age of 31. But even though that the creator died, the stuff was still popular, and the workload went to her now widow, name is Hajime Yamano, who went by the pen name Nekojiro Y, then later created this OVA, Cat Soup, or spearheaded this idea, even though he's not named in any of the credits for, as a director or as a writer, he spearheaded this idea as a way to express his feelings about his late wife's suicide by using the characters that she created to express them, making it a lifting tribute, basically, to what he's done out of this very disturbing short. So now on to the plot of Cat Soup. It follows the little brother Niyata as he finds out that his big sister Nyako was going to be taken away by Death himself, only to discover that he only took half of her soul. And the OVA follows Niyata and a half of Nyako as they travel through different worlds and biomes to find her other half. There are multiple things that stand out to me when I watch this. The first being the amount of symbolism in it. Even though Yamano isn't credited as either the director, writer, or an animator, or at least as much as I can tell, maybe he was in the credits. I did not check Anime News Network, which has a lengthy... They usually have a lengthy, like, credits list of who's a director, who's a writer, who's all the people that worked on it, and they were really good at that, and I didn't check that. So he's probably on that. But even though I didn't check to see if he was working on it at all, creatively, he was a huge part of this project, and there were so many different things and actions in here that can attribute to how he felt about his wife's death. My favorite was a scene towards the end of the short, and sorry, spoilers, where God, and yes, God is in this, he is turning back time and then brings it back to normal, which in my opinion, this is Yamano saying that he wishes he could turn back time so that he could do something to help her try and get through her depression. Or another one that I like, which is the beginning, which is when Nyako loses her half of her soul. I think that is symbolism for Yamano losing a half of his soul when his wife killed herself. It was a way to express that as well. But none of it would have been any close to impactful if it wasn't for the animation, especially for the head animator and the co-writer, Masaaki Yuasa. Not only was this guy make some of the most unique and unmistakable work in the anime industry, but he also has a way of storytelling that's hard to do, which is make the story impactful, which is with as little or limited of a plot that you have. And he excels at that, and then some, with Cat Soup. Every scene has a way of screwing with you, making you have a different reasoning as to what certain things mean compared to someone else who's watching this. You know, I might have a different reason when I see a certain scene compared to you. Or, for example, I'm just going to name off a random person. Let's say Garn Gigak watches this. And he sees it, and he sees certain scenes differently than I do. That's basically what's going to happen here, especially because Yuasa was working on it and the story that he was given. But overall, Cat Soup is my favorite experimental horror piece in this whole thing, because it has the ability to stand the test of time, not because of the many interpretations that can come from different people when watching it, but because at the end of the day, Cat Soup is so good that it really just defies any interpretation at all. This is an easy 10 out of 10. Thank you guys for watching this video. It's been a while since I made a video on this channel, and I didn't want to stop making. I never want to stop making videos on this channel, but, you know, stuff got in the way. Stuff will come back eventually. This is, I think, the first day in a while where I knew that I had a shot of filming, so it'll be a while before I can actually release it. But, again, if you like this video, hit the like button down below. If you want to see any more videos like this, then you can also hit the like button, also hit the subscribe button as well. If you want to watch any of the shows and the music video that I talked about, it's in the description. And with that, my name is Payne, and see you in the next video.